And welcome back. This is the RPG Chick. We are in Tir Evron, and blocked passage. This is actually where we have to go. It goes to the sun and shadow. So we spoke with, but we can't go that way. We have to go a very difficult way instead, of course. Spoke with Galloween. To this one.
Got it.
Who's this one? Rymrgand. I'm pretty sure I'm not going to take his favor. We can pray to all of them and speak to all of them, but we can only take one favor. We killed a bunch of his followers very recently in Noonfrost, so he may not be pleased with us if he's aware of that. I mean, he's a god, he should be aware of it. Let's look up, because there's a certain phrase we have to utter. Something like that. So let's look up. Actually, no. Deities. Rymrgand. Entropy, cold winter, bad luck, famine, and natural disasters. Manifests as a giant albino auroch moving amidst a great blizzard, and in the plodding footsteps of Rymrgand come death and disintegration. Pretty much believes that everything from death is not possible, or life is not possible without death, something like that. Once more you approach the shrine in the constellation of the Beasts of Winter. This time the cold emanating from the shrine is unmistakable. A thin frost has formed upon the edges of the stone. Pray to Rymrgand. You kneel before the shrine and prepare to recite the ritual words. I believe it's this one. There's a lot more phrases than there are deities. Oh, I know that one. That's in one of the books we found. Oh, I can't remember the name of it. We were in their dungeons, too. We found that nobleman's daughter there. They had hypnotized her. But, yeah, I can't remember the name of them. Sheesh. It's killing me, too. Some with a TH or something. There is death. There is life in death, and death in life. Is that it? I know it's a life song. Something else about cold? No. Okay. Oh, he didn't like that. Crap. We gotta fight stuff. Rain blight. Greater rain blight. Small rain blight. He's on A. Offensive spells, or chance, which I wanted him to be. He's all the way over here, just to destroy the small rain blanket out of the way. We got the rest soon. These gods are wearing us out.
Hey,
He only got to one phrase, so he didn't even get to... I'd like to summon a drake or something, but...
Got it.
That was easy enough. Pretty damaged, though. You kneel and close your eyes. As you pray, the blackness fades to white, and a howling wind fills your ears. The vision that slowly resolves itself is of a broad, frozen plain. You see a procession of elves in the distance, periodically fading into and emerging from the whiteness. They trudge over snowbanks, their heads down against the driving winds. As they trek past you, one man bundled in furs turns his head. You headed for Noonfrost and the Frost-hewn Breach, too? Before you can answer, he's lumbered ahead. You follow the caravan, and in a couple minutes you come to a wall of ice. It disappears into the pale emptiness overhead and stretches as far as you can see in either direction. The elves stop in front of a mirror-smooth section that's framed like a temple door. It seems somehow thinner from the rest of the wall. You can't see what's on the other side, but a debilitating cold emanates from within. The elves pull pickaxes and shovels from their sealskin packs and begin hacking at the smooth ice, their implements flying through the air in swift, shining arcs. Though they throw their bodies into their labor, not one of them so much as scratches the polished ice. Yet with each blow, something bellows in the distance. Adair calls out to the elves, "Hey, you might want to hold off on that." But that howling wind seems to swallow up his voice. Pelagina's head whips around to see where the bellowing is coming from. "Forget about the elves. We need to be ready to move." She turns again to face you, flexing her hands in the cold air. "Or fight." The elves hack away, seemingly oblivious to the furious lowing and to the tremors under your feet. The snow has risen to your knees. Your legs feel frozen in the drifts. Try to get the elves' attention. That didn't work before. You grab the nearest elf by her shoulder, shaking her and yelling over the howling winds. You point in the direction of the booming noise, but she only scowls. "Leave us, traveler. We've got to get through. We can't stay on this side any longer." "Listen, you're angering something very big. You'd better stop." The elf strains to listen. As she rests her pick in the mounting snow, some of her fellows pause in their labors. A man with a withered, frostbitten finger turns. He raises his maimed hand, and the others stop as well. They stand motionless for several seconds before you realize they've frozen entirely. You touch the elf nearest to you, and he crumbles into a mound of snow. A final gale blows past, scattering the remains of the elves in a chaotic flurry. You notice a single spider web crack in the smooth barrier. It's the only thing that mars the perfect surface of the ice. Whatever's on the other side of the strange doorway, you feel it tugging at you. Only when you look back and see the parallel gashes trailing behind your legs in the snow do you realize how strong its pull is.
"My end comes to all things in time. Seal the Frost-hewn Breach and instruct the pilgrims in the patience of Rymrgand."
So that's how you say that. A deep whisper carries from the crack. As quiet as it is, it shakes the ground beneath your feet. Well, we can go like the little boy who stuck his finger in the dam, or we can plug the hole with a handful of snow. You fill your hand with snow and shove it into the crack. It hardens instantly, and a hoary rime grows over the smooth surface of the frozen doorway, fusing it with the rest of the wall. When you take your hand away, a perfect crystal of ice remains in your palm. As you examine the crystal, the vision around you fades, but the unmelting shard of ice remains in your hand. We could actually speak to him. Oh, into the white void. Rymrgand showed me a vision of a gate, the frost-hewn breach, and the pale elves trying to open it. In the vision, the elves crumbled into snow, and I sealed the gate with an ice crystal that I still had when the waking dream ended. I found Noonfrost, Rymrgand's temple in Old Song. The frost-hewn breach must be here. When I find it, I can use the shard from the vision to close it according to Rymrgand's wishes. When you kneel at Rymrgand's shrine, you again see the wall with its glassy doorway of ice. There is a hole in it that fits exactly the shape of ice. Exactly the shape of the ice shard you received. Okay, so we don't get to actually speak to him. That's disappointing. I thought we could speak to him the way we talked to Galloween. He gave us a quest. I'm guessing this is in quest items. Glowing ice shard. Rymrgand gave you this jagged ice crystal when you prayed to him at Tir Ephron. It's supposed to control the frost-hewn breach in Noonfrost. The shard glows with a cold blue light. It hasn't melted at all since you received it. Okay, so we gotta go there and plug that up, and that should stop the cold from coming through. Okay. Nothing happens, you approach Whitaker's shrine. Of course not. Whale shrine. Okay, Berath. Berath. Yeah, I thought that was the right phrase. Maybe it doesn't matter what you say. They throw... enemies at you? So you can... to prove your worth or something? I figured they'd do us piss because we pray to them by the wrong phrase. Berath. Oh, maybe this is the one. God of death, cycles, doorways, mortality, and inevitability. The keeper of the cycle of life and death. Berath is sought to seek to is thought to claim the lives of those who have lived past their time. According to folklore, Berath is most often seen in the form of the Pallid Knight or the Usher, two skeletal characters who lead such people to their deaths by way of challenge or trickery. Okay, death and life for this one, I'm thinking. There is life and death, and death and life. There is a rippling shift in the air around you, as if some unfelt wind has changed, bringing unexpected warmth. You feel the peculiar weight of an unseen presence and of eyes upon you. You kneel and pray to Berath. Even while your eyes are closed, you see a road that seems to stretch on forever. The stars wheel overhead in a clockwork rotation of constellations, disappearing over the horizon to your left, only to rise on your right. You try to make out the details on either side of the road, but your eyes can't seem to focus. One moment you think you see a meadow blanketed with mist and another sheer canyon walls. For just an instant, you even see waves lapping at the edges of the road. Were you to step into the shifting landscape, you feel certain you would only end up back on the road. You know this is a vision, but the packed dirt feels firm beneath your feet and the night air cool on your face. You are walking. Your feet seem to carry you forward of their own accord. Something looms ahead of you. As you get closer, you see two stone figures that look strangely familiar. Canna says, "Our old friends, life and death and life, we're in the realm of the twin god, and here are its two aspects." Well, I got it right at least this time, guys. Right phrase, wrong altar. You remember the door to Cleobon Relag and the two figures carved into the mountain next to it. Right. The male and female. One looks vaguely male and the other vaguely female. Well, those figures definitely looked male and female. But, I guess this one looks less? Only a thin layer of flesh covers their skeletal bodies, which twist to face the doorway between them. The doorway, however, is not what you saw in the ruins. It's a skull, gaping and jawless, and as you look on, its open mouth seems to grow. The arms of the two stone sculptures are swept toward the mouth, inviting you in. Enter the skull's mouth. The road continues through the maw to another shifting landscape surrounded by stars. As you pass through it, you see an identical doorway in the distance. A dwarven man stands near it, unmoving. You turn and look behind you, only to see the skull gate you just passed facing you. An elven woman waits in the road. Like the dwarf, she stands still. My natural inclination is to approach the elven woman. You start toward her. There's something unnatural about the way she stands. She's too still. When you get closer, you see that her legs taper into a slender trunk, and in place of her feet are gnarled, twisting roots. She lifts her face to an invisible sun. Her long golden hair is the color of autumn leaves, and as you look more closely, you realize that her head is actually covered with tendrils and vines sprouting brilliant yellow leaves. Each glimmers with the essence of an entire soul. She gives you a beatific smile. As you look on, the leaves slowly fall from her head and settle at her roots. They melt into the path beneath her, and almost immediately, new leaves sprout in the place of the old. She reaches toward you, still smiling as roots spring from her fingertips. Her outstretched arms bar the path. Come, graft your soul to the golden grove. I'll take her hand. I'm not going to attack her. Her roots twine around your fingers, and as they do, they grow rigid and cold. Her outstretched arm petrifies, and as a rough stone bark overtakes her flesh, she can only look on in horror. You break away from her brittle grasp. Her feet are rooted in place, but she twists and writhes as if trying to flee her own dying limb. The petrification reaches her shoulder and spreads down her body, freezing it in a painful arc. It creeps up her neck, and she throws her face skyward like a drowning swimmer. The grayness covers her face, freezing her gasp in stone. Now that she is still in life, lifeless, you can continue past her. Huh. Interesting. Only the golden leaves on her head remain untouched, as you watch, they fall one by one to the path below. They shrivel as the shimmering essence fades from them. You lift your gaze and see the dwarven man standing further down the road. Let's approach him. You continue down the road toward him. He looks up as you approach, but you can't tell if he's looking at you or through you. His face is smooth but flaccid, as if the flesh has detached from the muscles underneath. As you look on, his face begins to change. Wrinkles crack at the corners of his eyes. His mouth sinks, carving deep lines from his nose to the corners of his lips. His jowls sag, and the loose flesh hangs like dough. He raises his cupped hands, they're covered in blood. He lifts them to his face and smears himself, from the newly creased forehead to the wattles of his neck. As he massages the dark, sticky fluid into his skin, the flesh wrinkles disappear. The hanging folds recede, and his flesh tightens as if readhering to his skull. He lifts his head, and this time you know he's looking at you. His renewed face looks like a mask, artificially smooth and still. Behind it, his black eyes are two hungry pits, yawning like the empty mouths of skulls. Come, make your sacrifice to the ethic knoll. His body blocks the path. He extends a bloody hand toward you. Great. Another person or being telling me to sacrifice myself. Take his hand. And what would happen if we attack him? You grab his hand, but his skin gives too easily under your grip. As you try to pull away, you hear a noise like dried canvas tearing. Oh, he ripped his skin right off. His skin splits, following a long seam that begins at his arm and stretches the length of his body. Blood gushes forth in such quantities that you can't imagine there was ever anything else in him. Crap. Sure enough, as the dwarf empties of blood, he collapses like a desiccated husk. The blood in the path gleams with 1,000 souls worth of essence. The essence evaporates, trailing shining filaments into the night sky. Only now that he is dead can you continue onward. The blood pools around your feet, and a voice echoes along the road, barely more than a whisper on the breeze. Return them to the wheel. You look up and see the skull gate ahead of you. The candles of Tyr Everon wink through the open mouth. Leave? End the lives of the two figures from Berath's vision. Berath tires of mortals evading the natural cycle of death and rebirth. He showed me two individuals in particular, a dwarven man and an elven woman, who have extended their lives for centuries. He showed me a vision of an elven woman and a dwarven man stopped on a road. My touch slew them, and only then was I able to continue along the path. I think this is the god's way of telling me that these two individuals have cheated death for too long. Ending their lives would no doubt please Berath. The dwarf in the vision had an eerily ageless face, and he seemed to renew himself with the blood of others. We gotta go back to Blood Sands, do we, and get that guy. I can't remember his name. Something worm? Worm something? Word? Wordna? Something, I think. Something word, actually. The dwarf in the vision had an eerily ageless face and seemed to renew himself with the blood of others. He said something about the ethic knoll. When I learn who or what this is, he will no doubt be nearby. The elven woman was strangely tree-like in the vision. She mentioned a place called the Golden Grove. The druids of the Golden Grove told me that High Ovate Irona often ventures to Elmshore in search of remedies to prolong her life. I suspect that Irona is the elven woman from the vision. Oh. I see now. It's the Hall of Warriors, or the Hall of Champions, out here in the Elm's Reach. That's why we got to speak with, so bad with names, Galloween. That's why we got to speak with him, because we already accomplished the task he would have given us. He would have given us that task now to to help, you know, just kill either the bear or the lioness, I believe. So because we've done that quest before he even gave it to us, just by looking around. So that's why we got to talk to him, but we can talk to them if we accomplish Berath's task or Rymrgand's task, which neither are far. I mean, one we have to go to Elmshore, the other we have to go to Noonfrost, and the other, well, it's Elmshore and the Golden Grove, and the other one's for Rymrgand is Noonfrost. Right. So now finally, this is Hylea. What's Hylea's story? Goddess of the sky, maternity, creativity, bird song, invention, language, and arts. Not known to take a particular physical form, but thought to be present in birds of all kinds. You stand once more before the shrine of Hylea. Was I saying Hylea again? The stars of her constellation seem to glitter all the brighter. Prepare to recite the ritual words. Okay, Well, she's everything about birds, so live every note of life's song. Your words seem to ring in the air, your voice rendered melodic and lilting by some unseen art. You shut your eyes to pray. As you wait in darkness, the world around you changes. You feel sunlight, bright and warm, on your face. A light breeze carries music to your ears. As vivid as these sensations feel, you somehow know they are not real. You look around and find yourself standing in an open-air temple built on a mountain summit. It's filled with elves, orlins, and assorted other kith. Ringing the entire scene is a fringe of trees, their verdant branches fill with the birds of all different colors, shapes, and sizes. You know, I remember that one... Was he a bard? Or just an entertainer, a singer? He wanted me to find different rare birds. I haven't found any. I haven't seen any yet. And then again, I haven't been looking. Durant spits. A paradise for those who would waste their lives exploring the meaningless while corrupting the meaning of the real world. Oh, to set these trees ablaze, Watcher. Everyone is singularly absorbed in a particular pursuit. An Orlin sits with a canvas, a paintbrush in his hand, and jars of green, blue, and yellow pigments at his feet. An elf and an Amawa standing to the side are locked in conversation, their expressions dancing with the light. Still others scribble stanzas of poetry or crude sketches on sheafs of paper, losing themselves in the delicate minutiae of lines and syllables. You feel the breeze again, and two elves basking in the sunlight shiver. Kanna says, look at this place! All these people coming together to share their creations and... Kanna frowns. What on earth is that painting supposed to be? The largest group gathers in the middle of the temple. They sing a lush, chaotic harmony, composed of several complementary melodies. Others drift toward the singers in ones and twos, as if buffeted by a gust of wind or phrase of the song. A ripple passes through the trees. You think it's the wind, but the chirping changes to screeching. Hundreds of birds take to the skies, all headed in one direction, away. The devotees glance at the trees, just barely distracted from their activities, but the wind picks up, scattering their pages of poetry and art, and ripping the songs from their lips. They look skyward, and you follow their gaze. A dark shape blots out the sun. You can't tell what it is, but as it unfolds and expands, it seems to fill the sky. The wind roars over the summit. Sorry, guys. It's a lot of reading. Adara says, that explains the birds. Before you can flee, a shadow falls over the temple. It begins as a stain in the corner and spreads, blotting out the flagstones. It reaches the nearest kith, a black-furred Orlin. The darkness swallows her, leaving only a puff of smoke in her place. The two elves that you saw earlier, a man and woman, flee. You get a brief image of them, huddled in the shadow of a mountain. They seem to see you, too, and they reach out, calling silently after you. The others, however, seem frozen. As the shadow advances, they likewise vanish one by one. The driving gale scatters their ashes and the charred remains of their creations. You look up again at the source of the shadow, but the eclipsed sun forms a binding corona around the thing. You can't make out any details. You can, however, feel heat. Restore my temple. You look down and find yourself standing next to Hylea's shrine in Tir Evron. Your pulse still races and your skin is damp with sweat from your strange encounter. A menace roosts in Hylea's temple and has scattered her worshippers. I've been tasked with facing this threat. Yes, we already received this quest to get rid of the dragon. It's actually a full dragon. We spoke with High Priest Casfa and High Priestess Anwen. Okay. That's going to be quite a battle. Hylea revealed a mountaintop temple beset by a terrible menace. Your prayers return you to the mountaintop temple, but this time you see only the ashes of the worshippers and their art. The shadow over the temple envelops you when you find yourself back in Tir Evron. Alright. I want to see if my companions have anything to say before we continue on and we're going to do these quests.
How may I help?
Any thoughts on what I should do next? Theos is already a step ahead of us. We've got to hurry if we're to catch him at Sun and Shadow.
Hey.
Adair? I want to ask you about you, if you're sure. Apparently we haven't asked him this. What did you do before this?
Oh, other than the war, I never strayed too far from where you found me. Farming, mostly. I was never much for cities. Never learned a trade. In my younger days, I thought I was going to go preach the word of Aethys, just in our temple there. My parents encouraged it. I made so much trouble for them growing up, they used to say it'd be best if I got in good with the God of Redemption. Of course, us blowing him up probably didn't help my chances there. But if anybody'd forgive you for blowing him up, it'd be Aethys.
Did the people of Gilded Vale really try to kill you?
They did. It was strange timing, because we just won the war. They celebrated when I came home. There was music and dancing. Trumbull used half his grain making this big honey cake. I still dream about that cake. Like having the best lover of your life, but only for one night. And they were all sorry to hear about my brother. It took a while for word of the purges to reach us. Aethasians being murdered in the streets. Cold morn and the like. No way would they let something like that happen in Gilded Vale. That's what they all said. But the weeks went by and the purges spread. Pretty soon they weren't so sure my brother fought for Deerwood. And they weren't so sure I did. Caught me by surprise after all the celebrating. Should have seen it coming after the tailor said he was going to fit me for some new clothes, but then all he wanted was my neck measurement.
I'm not sure why I'm saying this, but, really?
Nah, not that last part. But you had to think about it. Says a lot about the place I've been calling home all these years.
Why did you stay for so long in a town that hated you?
I'm sure my parents are still wondering the same thing. The Aethasian purges were like this madness had come over the town, like a disease. Seems like when you see something like that, your instinct is to wait for it to pass, even when you know it probably won't. The family whose farm I worked on, they had a little hollowborn girl. And they heard the Animancers had this cure, the Salvation it was called. They went running. This Salvation... they were putting animal souls in children. You might have heard about it. Giving them enough personality to care for themselves. Well, you can guess how that turned out. Matter of time, the children broke down. Became wild things. Monsters. Anyway, these farmers put the family dog's soul in their little girl. For a while, the girl, she's making eye contact, she's feeding herself. Albeit in a kind of messy way. And one day, she snaps. They found her gnawing on her brother's bones. Had to chain her up, put her in a cow pen.
My God.
Well, the mother, she wouldn't have anything to do with the girl after that. But the father, he'd visit every day. Feed her chickens, toss water on her once in a while to get the dirt off. Most of the village, they'd whisper about him. Poor man, they'd say. Sick with grief. He was just waiting for his daughter to look up one day and recognize her papa. He was waiting for her to get better. Didn't understand that at the time, of course, but these days I think about him a lot.
Well, I definitely don't remember that story, so...
what's on your mind? It makes two of us. What's on your mind?
Well, we can't ask him what we should do next.
Hmm?
Pelagina?
I'm ready. Need something?
How do you think things are going? You are like these dear woodens, always with a fire in your stomach, looking to spit flames at anyone who gets in your way. There are times for fighting, but not all problems need to be solved with a sword. Right.
Following your lead.
And finally, Durrance. I mean, duh, Canna?
Yes, my friend?
So sorry, Canna. Do you know anything about this place? Twin Elms, home of the six tribes of Ir Glanfath. I find the Glanfathans a curious people, as dedicated to the preservation of knowledge as Rorotai, but ferociously insistent that it remain in their keeping alone. One tribe, the Keepers of the Stone, claims to have been the first to make contact with the Engwith. There's little proof of either way, but I can't fault their dedication to keeping records. If nothing else, they could give us accounts of Ir Glanfath dating back to the first Glanfathan ship to land on these shores. Our two nations have much in common, I think. I wonder if they have any chance to share. How are you holding up? I'll make it. Besides, Takawa women have an eye for scars. I'll finally be as popular as the cannoneers.
It's good to be on the road again. A wanderlust is nothing rare in the people of Rawatai. But often I think myself alone in loving the land as much as the sea. What shall we see next, I wonder?
Let's be on our way and find out. Okay, most probably next episode I'm going to go back to Noonfrost and plug that thing and we can go back and talk to the god here. Or we can head right to the next objective. I'm going to complete these quests. I know we need to hurry up and get to Theos, but I do want to get the favor of the right god, as it were. Although I'm sure each would help in their own way. I'm really curious to what the others would have to say. So we have to solve their quests first in order to hear them. So, thanks for watching. See you next time, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.